So basic idea is to chat, actually, so.
Very well.
B and C mark. And A mark.
So you've had a fun day of doing this, I guess.
Yes. On the whole, I've been quite nice. I was a fraction ratty this morning, but I got nicer.
Do you have, you've been doing press now for 30 years. Is it exhausting? Have you gotten used to it? Does it ever get any better?
You get better at doing it. You get better at spotting the elephant traps set in front of you that are going to explode in your face, he said, mixing metaphors. But so far in the last week, I've only walked on one bomb.
You found one?
Yeah, I found one, yeah.
People still, actually, you think people still set them out for you the way they...
No, did? I'm just an idiot. I just set them off.
So was this part of what you signed on for when you decided to become an actor, was selling your movies, or did you figure that out pretty quickly?
Well, I didn't know anything about what happened on a movie when I first went into them. I didn't even know you had to do more than one take. The first time I was ever on a film set, it was actually in the Northwest Territories of Canada doing a strange miniseries, and I had to come out of a tent and fight my way through a blizzard and stare into the distance in close-up, and I did it, and I went back to the tent. I thought, well, I've done my performance now. Got on a skidoo and went back to the hotel. And that's when they had to say, no, you do several takes, then we do many angles. So the whole of filmmaking has been a process of learning over 30 years.
So how did you end up on that set if you didn't know anything about what you were doing?
Well, they cast me. I suppose I'd done some theatre, but I'd never done anything on film before. And no one in those days taught you.
Did you want to do, it was like being a film actor something you wanted, or it's kind of part of working?
No, it was a little bit of an accident. I mean, I liked acting. I'd always liked showing off in the limelight and all that kind of thing, you know, doing silly voices as a schoolboy and being in school plays. But I'd never set my heart on being a professional actor, no.
And was there a point where that became sensible to you, or an idea that, oh, this is going to be my career?
No, I'm still slightly wondering. I drifted into it a little bit. When I was at university studying English literature, there was a bloke who, an American who was at the university, who wanted to make a little student film. He got some cameras together, he borrowed them, and we made a student film, and it wasn't great. But after I graduated, and just before I went on to do a postgraduate degree somewhere else, this film had a little showing in London, and I went, and very much to my surprise, agent said afterwards, do you want to be an actor? Mm-hmm. And I said, no, I'm off to do an MPhil in History of Art, actually. And then I thought, well, you know, maybe I will do that for a year, because I've got no money and I need some money, and then I'll go back to writing essays. And so I said yes to the agents. And then and then I got a film immediately. I got a part in The Mutiny on the Bounty with Mel Gibson. And at that time in England, you weren't allowed to be in a film if you didn't have a union card. And you could only have a union card if you'd been in regional theatre. You're not even in London. You had to go outside London. And so I was so angry at not being allowed to do this quite juicy film that I went to Nottingham Playhouse and played interesting roles like Tree in Wind and Third Shouting Peasant. And I got a union card, and then I started doing little bits of film, and the whole thing sort of grew.
So when did it become real? I mean, was there a thing where you went, okay, now I'm stuck, now I'm...
Well, I've been sort of walking in the door of acting and out again continually for 30 years. I walked in with my equity card, and then I walked slowly out because I started instead doing a comedy show with two guys, and we were writing material, we were writing TV stuff and radio commercials, and I was very happy doing that. And then suddenly I got cast in a film called Morris, made by Merchant Ivory, and that dragged me back into just pure acting. And then after a few years after that, I was drifting out again, and Four Weddings suddenly came along and very much pulled me back in. And
did you think you were good? Did you think you were, did you see yourself as a fully formed
God, no.
Actor?
I thought pretty much I was appalling all the time. And one of the few things that propelled me forward into the next job was just wanting to prove to my friends and family, oh, I'm not that bad, I'm better than that. Because I always thought, I always thought I'm pretty darn good in rehearsal, but I used to freeze badly in front of the camera. I still freeze a little bit, but I had really bad freeze in those days.
Did you watch yourself? Did you watch your films after they were made, or?
Yes, but in the very early days, it was agony.
And now
I had a very self-conscious jaw in particular.
Huh.
So if I watch, you know, you find a bit of TV of me in the age of 24. I don't know why.
So when Four Weddings happened, did you see yourself as the happening rising movie star of the moment? I mean, because that's, you became an instant superstar.
Well, we didn't expect any success with that film. I remember watching a preview of it, and we all, me, the director, the writer, we all just wanted to emigrate to Peru when the film came out. And then, yeah, much to our astonishment, they had a screening here in Santa Monica, and people loved it. And that was all extremely surprising. Mm-hmm. And it was like winning the lottery.
So is the embrace like, now you get to work more, or was all the accoutrement of being a star attractive to you, or are you interested?
Yeah, of course. I mean, anyone would love all that stuff. Attention, money, girls, success. There's nothing to complain about.
There's nothing bad about being a movie star.
Well, there was nothing at that stage, certainly, yeah.
So how did this movie come into your life? Did you just get a phone call one day from Steven, or?
This one, Florence Foster Jenkins.
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of. I've been very involved with a political campaign in Britain, and he's been a supporter. He used to come to some of our parties and things, and he was always saying, oh, let's make a film. And I would say, I don't think so, Stephen. I'm sort of doing this now, and show business is something I was slightly in the past. And then, to my great surprise, he sent me the script, and it was brilliant. You know, it was genuinely funny, and I thought it was moving, and it had a nuanced and complicated part for me, and he was directing it, and Meryl Streep was going to be in it. And yeah, I would never have been able to look myself in the face if I had turned that down.
Mm. So what got you out?
Sorry?
When you say you kind of got into the politics, area of politics, and you weren't really acting.
Yeah, that's right.
Was it a conscious decision? Okay, I'm done for a while, I'm going to try something different? Or?
Well, yeah, I certainly wasn't putting any effort into a show business career at that point. Occasionally, things would pop up. That were really fun to do, like The Man from U.N.C.L.E. or Cloud Atlas or an Aardman cartoon, The Pirates, things like that. They were fun, kept my hand in. But really, my focus was elsewhere in life.
So you just didn't need it anymore, the adulation part of it? All the good
No, I definitely didn't, definitely didn't miss that, no, no, no.
But I mean, the attention, were you over with having that kind of attention? Were you kind of like matured into the next part of your life and acting was not necessarily going to be a part of it?
Yeah, I think that was the feeling, yeah, yeah.
Mm. And you were absolutely at peace, I guess, with that.
Oh, I've never been at peace, don't be ridiculous. But yeah, I was never thinking, oh, I wish I was doing more acting or anything like that. No.
And is going back to a set any different? Does it feel like, you know, getting back on the horse after a few years away?
Well, I suppose that added to anxiety. There was plenty of anxiety anyway in the fact that this was Stephen Frears, who I was still quite frightened of, and Meryl bloody Streep, you know, with 19 Oscar nominations. It was quite a scary first day. First days are always scary, but this one was particularly terrifying.
So did you become comfortable quickly, or did it take a while?
Well, actually, I did. I did. Stephen is remarkably trusting. You know, I remember going to have a cup of tea with him after I accepted the part, and I had sort of 20 interesting questions about the script and the character, and with each one I'd say, and what do you think of this moment? He'd go, oh, I don't know, whatever you think. Well, you make up your mind. And that's how he is, and so that actually builds your own confidence. So that was one thing, and then you've got Meryl Streep. You see, although it's initially frightening, once you're doing it, it's like playing tennis with Rafa Nadal. You play better because it brings your game up.
And has that been true with all of your high-end co-stars over the years? I mean, is it?
Yes, yes. And the reverse, I'm afraid, is true. If you get someone who's maybe brand new or, you know, is playing a small part, very scared, not confident, you come right down, because that makes everyone tense.
So what makes you feel good about what you're doing? I mean, what are the pleasurable parts in the process for you? Are you a big prep person? Do you?
I don't know that pleasure is the right word, but it can be very, very satisfying. You know, in the end, this film has been immensely satisfying for me because it was quite a challenge. I did do lots of prep. Was that enjoyable? Yes, in a way it is, I suppose. It's enjoyable creating, getting more and more precise about the character. You've got a little template there of the script, and in this case I also had the template of the real man, because he really existed. And I went into both in enormous detail, and I keep a file, and the file gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and I invent more and more and more about the backstory until, you know, I virtually know where I went on summer holidays when I was 14. Mm. I don't know if any of that's useful, but in a way it's quite fun. It's almost like a sort of, you're writing a novel or something.
Did you develop that method kind of on your own, or did you, were you trained in doing things like that? Or?
I think I can't remember where it comes from. I think it is actually quite classic, sort of an actor prepares, sort of Stanislavski stuff, yeah.
Doesn't seem very British, though.
No, I know, and I think that's right. I think it's not, but what I've found after years of doing films is that the Americans had it right with film acting, and the Brits had it wrong. I think we're fine with theatre, the British sort of theatrical acting tradition. But when it's on film, some of the things I noticed American actors doing, I think they're right. For instance, you know, when it came to rehearsal, they would never put anything into it. They just mumble. Nah, 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 nah. And you think, come on, give it. But what they're doing is they're preserving all their instincts and freshness for the moment when there's film in the camera and they're in close-up. And they're absolutely right to do that. Well, all us British actors would give enormous enthusiasm to rehearsal. And by the time we got to the close-up, we were bored of the performance, bored of ourselves, you know, repeating things we'd done before. So in many ways, I think American actors know what they're doing with film, and all that stuff that I used to slightly sneer at, you know, method acting, and I especially watching Meryl do it, it works. It definitely works.
Well, your charm is so profound, for better or for worse. I mean, but for you, but is it? I think people kind of have always assumed that it was, you know, you kind of came in there and you were naturally Cary Grant, and that was easy somehow. But it's fascinating that you found you have to work so hard.
Well, maybe it's not necessary in all cases, but it helps me with nerves anyway to think, oh, I know this inside out. I've anatomized it and I can put it back together again. But it maybe it's not necessary.
Do you have that sense of how people perceive you as this charming, rakish guy?
Well, I don't know. So, I mean, maybe some people do because of the roles in some films. Yeah, maybe.
Is it a boundary? Is it a limit to you? I mean, did you want to stretch further and find people wanting to, you know, kind of keep you in that rom-com-y box?
Well, it was never particularly an issue for me. I have only ever thought, what's the best script that's in front of me at one time, and then done that. I never thought, I want to do lots of romantic comedies. I never had any particular interest in that genre. They just happened to be the scripts that I responded to at one period of time.
Mm. And directors? Huge difference from one director to the next for you?
Yes. But what's interesting, I was talking to you just now about Stephen being very trusting and therefore minimal and really saying very little. And I have found that the some of the most famous directors I've worked with, Polanski, Woody Allen, they're incredibly silent. If you try and engage them about plot or character, they're not interested.
Which you like, or you don't? Is it easy?
No, I think I do quite like it. Occasionally you come across a director who really wants to talk earnestly about backstory, and alarm bells ring immediately. Those are the micromanagers. And what you realize is very good filmmakers realize you can't control film that much. Mm-hmm. And in a way, the best thing to do is to let it happen. Get the best people you can, best technicians, best cast you can, and then see what happens.
So for you, script first and director second, or will you go to do a movie because of the director? Or?
Well, occasionally there have been really famous directors who've come to me with what I thought were pretty dodgy scripts, and I haven't done it. Yeah. Mm. I think you've got to have both.
And working with Meryl?
Yes.
Is that just a unique proposition? Can you feel the Merylness of her as you're working with her?
Yes, I think you can. I mean, it's a combination of two remarkable things. One is just a ridiculous excess of talent. And you can't put your finger on where that comes from. And then the other is this extraordinary devotion to the craft of acting. And, her determination, her vow to be emotionally true to every emotion in the film. And she brings it to the set. There she is. If it's a happy scene, she's happy. If it's an angry scene, she's angry.
And is it a very different energy than somebody like Julia Roberts or Sandra Bullock? I mean, obviously they're great stars in their own right and bring something unique, but is it that they're bringing something that's very different than each other?
Well, now everyone's up to the same thing, really, I suppose, but what's particularly hard on a film, you're filming it for, 8, 12 weeks, and they're very long hours, 12, 14 hours a day, and you're on, off, mostly off, and then a moment on, and then off, is keeping up the focus and concentration. It's so easy to drift off into eating the biscuits and having a laugh with your co-stars. And what impressed me about people like Meryl is mm-hmm. it's absolute 100% fierce focus all the time. Yeah. I mean, not to say she never relaxes, I'm sure right. she does, but when she's on set, she's bang there. You wouldn't have a day where, like I had with Bullock, for instance, where neither of you can control your giggling.
And is that a joy when that happens?
Or
is that when you can't control yourself and you're just being silly?
Or? Well, yeah. Although the crew laugh with you for the first four times you've wrecked the take. And on take 16, they're looking at their watches thinking, come on, we've got a lunch break coming up. Mm. And then that makes you laugh even more because of the panic.
But it sounds like fun.
Well, I did love doing that film with Bullock.
Is acting what you expected it to be when you decided to be an actor?
I don't know. I didn't really know what to expect, I don't think. No. I never had any expectations, you see, of doing it as a career, so I can't really answer your question.
So still no expectations after all these years?
No, I know pretty much the whole cycle now, from script comes out of envelope to film opens in Australia. It's all divided into little phases, and the emotions tend to be roughly similar with all of it, with every film. They differ slightly whether people like the film or not. Mm. But
Are you paying attention to whether, are you worrying about grosses or worrying about reviews or things?
Yes, yes. And I always think people who say they're not are liars.
So what's the best review you ever got?
I don't know. I've had some nice reviews on this film, and even in Britain, which is very rare for me.
Are they tough on you at home?
Well, they tend to be. And very nice reviews. The tomato meter went mad for this film.
Was it easier being in politics for the time you were focusing on that?
Well,
no. More rough and tumble than this? Or
much more rough and tumble. Really hardcore. Really hardcore. No one's licking your ass there because you're a so-called celebrity. In fact, they despise you for it. And you're out there on a serious political program on the BBC up against someone intelligent but who is your enemy and debating stuff. And it's quite bracing, really. It's not exactly, Entertainment Tonight.
More stimulating?
Yes, more satisfying, but scary.
So are the British politics tougher than, you're seeing this drama we're having in the United States right now. I mean, is it rougher there? I mean, it seems to be much more public that everybody actually talks about one another and will attack each other in public a little bit more aggressively. Usually we save that for not the public. Mr. Trump is talking a lot and saying a lot of terrible things. But I mean, is it a different fight?
No, it turns out to be it's pretty hardcore. It's hardcore in the flesh. It's even more hardcore online. Your enemies, I believe the verb is flame you on Twitter, and that can be disagreeable. And the particular opponents that I'm up against, which is a few really hardcore and powerful tabloid newspapers, are about as scary as you can get in terms of opponents. They'll take no prisoners.
So is there an end to, end to what you're chasing there in terms of politics?
Well, we thought we'd kind of got there. We managed to get a big public inquiry, and we got new laws passed by Parliament. The trouble is this new government in Britain have gone back to being so scared of these few big newspaper bosses that they're now trying to pull every trick to long grass the legislation. And our job is to make sure they don't.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
Did you know the fight was going to be there when you got into it?
No, I thought I'd just be standing up and doing a few interviews for a few weeks. Now it's 5 years, and big deal.
So have you taken pleasure from that?
Yes, obviously it's been frightening and alarming at times, but a lot of satisfaction, it feels nice to stand up for something you really believe in. It feels right, and I've enjoyed the camaraderie of fellow campaigners. That's been marvelous.
And so comes next? Do you go back towards movies again? Do you stick with...
Well, I will basically go back to politics, but I don't know. There's some interesting things dangling in front of me in terms of show business, and I never quite know when I'm suddenly going to reach my paw up and swipe one.
Was it fun to go a little older in this movie? It was an interesting thing that you were... One of the shocking things watching the movie, having not seen you in a couple of years, was...
Is how old I look. Thank you.
Well, they seem to go... But now that I see you here, I know that they went well out of their way to make you look as old as possible.
No, that is simply not true, actually. We did nothing to make me look older. I just look that old. maybe it's the clothes. But no, I'm afraid that is the way I am.
Are you self-conscious of how you look? Are you aware of how you look? Is that...
Well, I'm aware that people on Twitter and so on say, you know, my God, he's aged badly. He looks like a scrotum.
Somebody said that?
Yes.
That's terrible.
Yes.
So why do you go on Twitter if people are saying these terrible things?
It's a huge elementary mistake.
Do you Google yourself also?
No, I try not to do that. But I went on Twitter. I didn't want to go on Twitter. I despise social media. But my fellow campaigners made me have a Twitter account. And I said, look, I really don't want to have one because I don't want the flack. And they said, well, don't read it. But then, of course, after a few beers, have another look.
It's always sucks you. And do you respond when people attack?
No, I've not been a responder. Someone said, don't feed the trolls. And that's probably correct.
Probably good advice for your entire career.
Yes,
exactly. As things have gone along.
Yeah.
Has having your life been as public as it's been at times the bad part of having chosen to be an actor?
I think you kind of expect a bit of that. That's going to happen. I think it always has historically happened. But I have objected very strongly to people around me, my elderly father, my two-year-old son, etc., being exploited for a kind of crazy show business press, yes.
And has it gotten better or worse, do you think, as it's become democratized? Or at least we think it's been democratized, right?
Yeah, it hasn't really got much better in Britain. It is what the whole campaign was about. It's not,
right.
Well, it's not about celebrities. It's about intrusion into people's lives, specifically people with tragedies, like people who lost children in road accidents or terrorist atrocities and things like that, having their phones hacked or having their medical records stolen, all for newspapers to make a profit with. And that's what I've been campaigning about. But I'm not particularly bothered by the likes of me having my, you know, stories written about me in the newspaper.
And do you run into yourself on the telly in places? and watch?
You mean flicking the channels?
Yeah.
Yeah, that happens. Yeah.
Do you watch?
I can watch to 5 or 10 minutes, and then I recoil.
Is there anything you love watching? Is there anything you go, I did
that, I'm rather I did good. Well. No, I think there's only two scenes I've ever done well in the whole of my career. So if they're on, I've watched that, yeah.
And you're not going to tell us what they are?
Nah.
I'm so curious now. are they scenes we would expect? Are they scenes, you know, are they scenes where people go?
No, they're very, I actually, to be honest with you, in Florence Foster Jenkins, there's a lot that I'm quite pleased with, an uncharacteristic amount. But prior to that, really what I'm talking about is there were very few scenes where I felt I'm as relaxed and good in the performance on camera as I was in rehearsal, mm-hmm. or when it was the other guy's close up. That's the continual agony of filmmaking. And there's just a couple of scenes where I thought I was.
And how did you first see this movie, Florence Foster Jenkins?
Well, again, Stephen Frears was incredibly inclusive, and very early in the editing process, he said, Hugh, come in, have a look at the film, tell me what I'm doing wrong. So I'm afraid I exploited that opportunity and have been in and out of the editing room for the last year.
And did that give you peace of mind in terms of what you had done?
Well, I thought I'm not bad in this film, but then the whole new anxiety starts of, you know, let's not cut that scene, and, you know, oh no, don't cut to that person, you know, things like that.
Did you ever want to direct?
Yes, I would quite like to do that. The only thing I found, because I produced a few films, is that it's surprisingly difficult to stay passionate about the same story for effectively 2 years, really. You know, I found it even producing, by the time you get to doing the Foley effects, the end of year two, enough already. Let's have a fresh story.
So 4 or 5 months of production is plenty for you.
Yeah.
In terms of the experience.
Yeah, that would be, if the technology of filmmaking could be from writing the script to if it comes out in the cinemas 5 months, everything would be perfect. Yeah.
So when you get a kind of positive response like you are to this movie, is that, it all worked out? Or does that fulfill the answer to whether you should have done this or whether this was your pleasure?
Yes, it makes me feel much better. And it's lovely when people are nice. And yes, of course. You feel, you just have a few moments when you think maybe it's all been worth it.
It seems like it would be more fun for you than it sounds like it's been.
What, my career or this film?
Your movie career.
I'm an anxious person. I manage to find anxiety and misery where other people can't.
Mm. And you find pleasure somewhere in it?
Yeah.
Usually, there must be pleasure
usually
in there somewhere,
outside,
right?
The process of filmmaking, I found lots of pleasure.
So real life is a better place?
For me, yes, for me, yeah.
But the filmmaking journey hasn't been too bad.
I have loved some things. I mean, really loved some things. Rather like with the campaign, loving the camaraderie, I've loved the teamwork of filmmaking, and I really think there is a sort of beauty in that, getting all these different experts together and creating something out of completely thin air. You know, it didn't exist before, now it exists, and you went through all kinds of agonies and late nights and worries and bitch fests to create it, and there it is, and that's properly satisfying.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was great.
Thank you.
That was fun.